He was a high-profile millionaire making waves in Atlanta.
He loved to be about town. He fancied himself as kind of a Great Gatsby.
She was an exotic island beauty in search of the American dream.
She was ambitious, she was intelligent, and she was trying to better herself.
When their stars collide, their steamy romance plays out like an X-rated movie.
Sexually, they were like fireworks. He told people that she satisfied him in a way that no one else satisfied him.
But just when their carnal lust reaches its peak, an intimate secret is exposed.
For him to have such a secret life, that was a shock.
And the consequences are deadly.
When someone is beaten that brutally, blood splatters everywhere.
Investigators soon uncover a bevy of beautiful suspects, each with their own lurid connection to the victim.
He really led a secret life. Sometimes that would include threesomes, foursomes.
There were lots of people who had motive. There were lots of people who had opportunity.
This was one of the most gruesome scenes that I had seen. The question is, who was angry enough to have done this?
August 8, 1996. It's a serene morning in the upscale Atlanta suburb of Roswell, Georgia. But that tranquility is shattered when police receive a desperate 911 call. On the line is Jackie Herndon.
Emergency, somebody done killed my baby.
Okay, tell me what's going on.
I don't know, I came in the house, he's 40 years old, I found him in the bed. Hurry, police.
Police rush to the address and race upstairs to the master bedroom.
Police department.
What they find is unsettling to even the most seasoned officers.
Room is unbelievably bloody. The sheets are covered in blood. The pillowcases are covered with blood. It is a very terrible scene.
In the bed is the naked, lifeless body of a middle-aged African-American male.
Major crimes and forensics.
His head was battered in a very forceful way, no less than 14 times.
The victim is identified as Jackie's son, 41-year-old Lance Herndon, a successful and highly regarded businessman in the Atlanta community.
Lance was a high roller. He had a beautiful home in Roswell. He had nice vehicles. He dressed well. He took care of himself.
He's been down about 12 hours.
As medics pronounce Lance dead, police begin to process the scene. But what nobody inside this upscale Atlanta home can fathom are the twisted skeletons lurking inside the closet of one of the city's rising stars.
I've described Lance as somewhat of an iceberg. I mean, what you saw was what was sticking out of the surface, but below, there was a lot of other stuff going on.
Born in 1955, Lance Herndon grew up in the historic New York neighborhood of Harlem. With both of his parents working full-time, Lance was the classic latchkey kid.
His mother left notes whenever she needed to tell him something. So Lance mostly was raised by babysitters.
The absence of his parents, particularly his mother, seemed to affect Lance's ability to foster lasting relationships with the opposite sex.
It goes back to that lack of relationship with his mother. He was still trying to fill that void that was missing. He really did not know how to relate to women.
But one thing Lance did learn from his parents was the value of hard work. Lance poured his heart and soul into his professional life.
Lance Herndon was a very bright man, a very driven man, a very disciplined man.
Lance moved to Atlanta to pursue a career in computer science, and then he started his own company, Access Inc., which staffed computer staff personnel to different companies.
And in his 30s, his hard work and unparalleled salesmanship netted him some highly coveted customers.
Lance had some really impressive clients. IBM, Nations Bank, Citibank, Coca-Cola.
He was considered one of the top 100 black entrepreneurs in the country.
With his business booming, Lance built his dream home, a colonial-style estate in the Northcliffe neighborhood of Roswell that also acted as the headquarters for his company.
The top floors were reserved for their private home, and Access Inc. was in the basement.
It wasn't just Lance's business that was booming. For a man who'd previously had trouble hitting it off with the opposite sex, Lance's multi-million dollar company and sprawling estate certainly made it easier for him to connect with the ladies.
He had a lot of money. And for someone with power and stature, Atlanta was ripe for the picking for women.
I think he couldn't help it. He seemed to care for the girls, but he wasn't satisfied. He was addicted. He needed more and more and more.
By the time he was 40, Lance had been married and divorced 3 times. But even though he seemed addicted to the Playboy lifestyle, Lance longed to meet that special someone.
Lance needed to be loved. He was still trying to fill that void that was missing.
Lance celebrated his 41st birthday with a lavish party. It was there that he was introduced to an Atlanta bombshell he'd never seen before.
Lance, meet my friend Dion.
Dion.
29-year-old Dion Baugh.
Happy birthday.
Thank you.
The two connected instantly.
Dion was from Jamaica. She was petite. She was attractive. She was enrolled in college at Georgia State. And I think it's fair to say that Dion wanted to climb to heights that she had not achieved in her life.
Lance was intrigued by Dion. He liked small, you know, petite, fair-skinned women. She had this Jamaican accent that made her exotic. And the relationship took off suddenly.
The Jamaican beauty and the Peachtree City power player soon became inseparable, though most of the couple's time together was spent in the bedroom.
He met his match with Dion. He told people that she satisfied him in a way that no one else satisfied him.
I love her gift.
In exchange for nurturing him both sexually and emotionally, Lance showered Dion with lavish trips and luxurious gifts.
Oh my God, baby.
And even helped pay for her schooling. Anything Dion desired was hers for the asking.
He started to buy her jewelry and expensive gifts and bought her a brand new Mercedes.
She really thought, I've made it. I have struck it rich. I love him. He loves me. I'm going to marry him.
But just as Dion and Lance seemed ready to tie the knot, their relationship was cut short in brutal fashion. It starts when Lance's mother reports finding his body in his palatial master bedroom early on the morning of August 8, 1996.
She has found her son dead, naked, in bed, bludgeoned to death.
But as police begin to dissect the scene, they'll soon discover that Lance Herndon's life of luxury did more than allow him to land the woman of his dreams. It also allowed him to indulge other dark fantasies. Fantasies that may have led to murder.
He was such a well-respected businessman. Nobody really would have guessed that he had this kind of seedy sex life behind the scenes.
Lance Herndon was considered one of Atlanta's top businessmen.
He really did embody the entrepreneurial spirit of African Americans during the 90s.
But while Lance succeeded in business, his personal life was less fortunate. That is, until he met a 29-year-old Jamaican-born beauty named Dion Baugh.
She was very fair-skinned. She was from the islands. It was an eye candy, another eye candy for him. It was a chase for him.
But Lance and Dion's red-hot romance was snuffed out when Lance's mother discovered her son's dead body in the master suite of his sprawling suburban mansion.
There is blood all over the bedroom, and Lance Herndon has been bludgeoned to death.
His skull had been smashed multiple times. He'd been beaten brutally.
Judging from the state of rigor mortis, it appears Lance had been dead 5 to 7 hours. But as they survey the scene inside the opulent master bedroom, investigators can't help but wonder if someone targeted the dashing businessman for his money.
Lance Herndon had become a very powerful man. He was very successful. He was making money, and people recognized him.
But an initial search of Lance's residence suggests otherwise.
Nothing of value is missing. His wallet is on the table. Money's still in it. His IDs are still there. Everything of value is still in place.
But in Lance's office, Investigators determined there is one item of value missing.
That might be a laptop.
Check that bag.
They noticed his laptop wasn't there.
Lance was a shrewd businessman in the dog-eat-dog world of technology. Is it possible his murder was the work of an adversary looking to take out their primary competition?
He also had other things going on from a business standpoint that could have created other suspects in this case, other people that had an axe to grind with him, other people that broadened the field of suspects.
According to Lance's mother, who made the initial 911 call, the idea that her son was loathed by his competitors doesn't hold water.
They're telling the police everything that they know about Lance. They don't think he has any enemies. He got along with everybody and he was very well respected.
And as investigators survey Lance's battered corpse, they begin to see another, more personal motive behind the crime.
The police theory was that it was a crime of passion, meaning someone was very upset or mad because they didn't strike him once or twice, but actually many times.
Detectives also notice a few other strange clues scattered around Lance's bedroom.
There was a couple of porn tapes. There were condoms on the dresser or on a counter.
He's obviously in bed when he's killed. Whether he's in bed when the person arrived or not, it's not clear.
The pattern of the blood was a V pattern that even extended to the ceiling. And so the theory was that whoever committed this crime was straddling Lance and was hailing down these terribly violent blows in a very forceful way.
The murder weapon is nowhere to be found, but Lance's housekeeper offers police a possible clue.
The maid tells police that a large crescent wrench is missing from the house. It had been there consistently every day, and all of a sudden it was missing. So they think that could possibly be the weapon, but they can't find it.
The missing crescent wrench isn't the only roadblock investigators have hit. There's little in the way of physical evidence, save for a single hair found on Lance's abdomen.
Other than the pubic hair that was found on Lance Herndon's body, the police investigators found very little direct evidence to link to the murder.
But that single hair, combined with the apparently intimate nature of the crime, has investigators angling to speak to just one person, Lance's girlfriend, Dionne Baugh.
I think they ended up focusing on Dionne Baugh reasonably quickly. Lance was a person that she was admitted to being sexually active with.
Locating her at home in Norcross, investigators informed Dionne of her lover's death.
Hey, guys, what's going on?
We did advise you that Lance Herndon has passed. Oh,
she's crying. She's hysterical. She collapses in the yard. She's hysterical on the ground, screaming about Lance.
Although Dionne seems genuinely devastated, detectives still have a few questions and bring her into the station for a formal interview. Once at the station, detectives take a much more aggressive stance.
They interrogated Dionne for hours, and she denied that she had anything to do with it.
She painted her relationship with Lance as a rosy one, that they had a great relationship.
Dionne admits to police that she saw Lance the evening he was killed, but Dionne claims they got together at her house, not at Lance's estate. Dionne's statement also explains where the missing laptop went.
She acknowledges that he had dropped by and brought her his laptop computer because she needed to use it for her schoolwork. And the time frame that she gave was between 9 and 10:30 p.m. that night.
According to Dionne, Lance wanted desperately to spend the night with her, but she needed to study.
Lance wanted to stay with her, according to Dionne, and she was devastated that she didn't spend that last night with him.
I've gone over in my mind so many times, I wish I'd let him stay with me. I wish I'd let him stay with him.
Based on Dionne's statement, investigators believe she is telling the truth. And given the fact that they weren't married, Dionne has no apparent motive to murder her lover.
He was probably worth more to her alive than dead.
But just as they are wrapping up the interview, Dionne reveals a piece of shocking information.
Did you know many of his friends?
No, and I purposely wanted it that way, so I didn't want people to see me with him and know that I was married. I did that for my own protection.
Right. Police were shocked. Dionne was married. She was married to a man named Sean Nelson.
a Jamaican pilot, and they had had a daughter who was 4 years old.
He lived in Jamaica, but even still, he and Dion continued their relationship. It was a commuter relationship.
He loved Dion. He was faithful to Dion, and he thought that she was faithful to him.
But during her interview with police, Dion admits that over time, Sean began to suspect she was seeing someone behind his back, someone wealthy.
He comes in town, he discovers that his wife has some designer clothing and is now driving a brand new car.
He knew she couldn't afford that, and I think they realized that she had to have a sugar daddy somewhere.
Dion says the situation came to a head shortly before Lance's death.
Yes, who is this?
There was one point where Sean had come in from Jamaica to visit Dion, and the phone rang, and it was Lance calling Dion.
Sean starts asking, who are you? And Lance is asking him, who are you?
This is our husband, Sean.
Wait a minute. Dion.
The fight started over the phone. And I think Lance said something pretty aggressive, like, you better watch your back or something. And apparently, Sean was really, really afraid.
The fact that Dion's husband, Sean, knew about her affair shoots him to the top of the suspect list.
Sean would have also been a natural suspect because he could have just either murdered Lance himself or hired someone to do it.
But in order to speak to Dion's husband, investigators must venture into international waters, where a few, even more sinister secrets lay hidden beneath the surface.
Don't see murder cases like this. A real honest-to-God whodunit is actually pretty rare these days.
In the posh suburbs of Atlanta, millionaire businessman Lance Herndon and his Jamaican lover Dion Baugh shared a life few could imagine.
He wanted to just open up Atlanta to her, so he took her out. He spent a lot of money, and he courted her, and she responded to that.
But when Lance is found brutally murdered in his own bedroom, investigators question Dion and learn the couple's relationship wasn't everything it appeared to be.
Dion was actually married. She had a husband named Sean who lived in Jamaica with their 4-year-old daughter.
This is Sean.
Not only that, but according to Dion, shortly before the murder, Lance and her husband had a heated exchange.
Don't ever call my house again.
Maybe I won't call.
Maybe I'll just come over there. How about that? Don't ever call my house again.
Within this conversation, between the screaming and yelling, threats were made.
Dion also informs police that Sean was actually in town the day of the murder.
Sean had been in Atlanta visiting Dion just before the murder. How ironic that he left for Jamaica the evening Lance was killed.
Police are anxious to talk to Sean Nelson, but Dion explains that Sean technically still lives in Jamaica.
Once an unalibied suspect leaves the country, concrete leads may quickly deteriorate. Continuing the investigation brings on legal, economic, and time constraints.
But with the help of Sean's airline employer, detectives are able to track him down. They make the trip to Jamaica to interview Sean at his home.
Can I help you?
The investigation was very thorough. They did go to Jamaica. They interviewed her husband down there, found out a lot about what happened.
Sean readily admits his wife's affair left a bitter taste in his mouth, but he's adamant he had nothing to do with Lance's death.
I hated him. I hate what he did to my family.
As detectives continue their conversation, it becomes evident Sean couldn't have committed the crime.
Time of death indicates Lance was killed sometime between 2 and 3 a.m. By this time, Sean was already heading back to Jamaica. In fact, he had already landed.
Thank you very much.
With their investigation at a standstill, detectives reach out to friends and family for more information about their victim. In doing so, they unearth another unexpected surprise. Turns out Dion wasn't the only one juggling multiple lovers. Not by a long shot.
They said that they couldn't keep up with the amount of people that he was sleeping with.
Lance had a harem of women, and he saw women as objects and someone that he could lay with, play with, and when he was finished, he would put them aside and he'd pick up the next one.
But in Lance Herndon's binders full of women, one appears to stand out, a gorgeous brunette named Kathy Connor he met at a party.
Kathy was beautiful. She knew how to stand, how to sit. Very classy lady, and he enjoyed having Kathy on his arm.
But it's not Kathy's good looks that pique investigators' interest.
Police processing the scene find a picture of a woman, a beautiful woman dressed in a white gown. The woman is Kathy.
According to Lance's friends, Lance was as hot and heavy with Kathy as he was with Dion.
She had the clothes in the closet. She was allowed to stay over when other women had to leave after he was finished.
Kathy was what most would have considered his sort of trophy. If you saw Lance out at a formal event, it was probably with Kathy. She was definitely eye candy for him publicly.
Which, to investigators, explains the real reason Lance and Dion weren't living together and why they seemed to spend most of their time getting it on in the bedroom rather than hitting the town.
Kathy did not know about Dion. Dion did not know about Kathy.
Is it possible that Kathy eventually found out about Dion and murdered Lance in a jealous rage?
Obviously, Lance had cheated on her quite a bit, so she would have been a natural suspect as well.
But detectives don't have to wait long for a chance to speak with Kathy. 1 week into the investigation, she storms into the police station.
She sashays in, she sits down, and she's mad. She's upset because the police have not allowed her to go back into the home to get her clothes. So the police are thinking this woman is more concerned about her expensive clothes than she is her boyfriend.
Investigators cut to the chase.
So where were you then?
She tells them that she was going to spend the night with another millionaire.
Detectives look into Kathy's story and determine she did indeed spend the evening with her other lover, another of Atlanta's wealthiest black businessmen.
Police were able to verify everything that Kathy said, so she was ruled out.
With Kathy Connor in the clear, investigators turn to the next woman on Lance Herndon's overflowing Rolodex of lovers, one who appears to be the wildest and perhaps most lethal of them all.
Lance would lend her to his friends. She basically would do anything that he asked of her in exchange for financial gain.
In a suburb of Atlanta, Georgia, detectives are on the hunt for the killer of wealthy businessman Lance Herndon. And after running down a pair of rival girlfriends and one jealous husband, they're now focusing on the millionaire playboy's vast portfolio of lovers.
I think it's probably fair to say that Lance's bedroom had a revolving door.
The suspect pool for the investigation involved mostly all women.
But in speaking to Lance's friends and family, there's one name in that pool that keeps popping up. Lance's part-time assistant, Lacey Brown.
It was reputed that they had a romantic or sexual relationship that was ongoing for quite some time.
Investigators ask Lacey to come by the station for an interview. Lacey agrees, but when she arrives, she's not alone.
Lacey knew that her story might be questioned, so she showed up. She had an attorney.
Obviously, as her counsel, we're going to reserve the right to stop this interrogation or interview at any point in time.
Some people may look at the fact that Lacey showed up to the interrogation with a lawyer as partly guilt.
First initial question is, what kind of relation did you have with him?
It was sexual as well, just purely sexual.
Okay, and when was the last time you seen him?
Actually, the night that he was murdered.
Lacey tells the police that she was with Lance on the night of the murder.
He was sleeping with Lacey. She could have killed Lance.
But Lacey insists she's innocent of any crime. She says she left Lance's house around 10 p.m. on the night in question, with Lance very much alive at the time. Lacey also claims she spoke with Lance again via phone shortly after she arrived home.
They chatted for just a bit, and when she hung up around 10:30 or 11 or so, that was the last time she spoke with him.
Investigators are puzzled. Lacey Brown's alibi places her with Lance Herndon at the exact same time another potential suspect claimed to be with Lance, Dion Baugh.
Dion said he had dropped by and brought her his laptop computer because she needed to use it for her schoolwork. And the time frame that she gave was between 9 and 10:30 p.m. that night.
Not only does Lacey's alibi conflict with Dion Baugh's, but Lacey also claims that Lance was still using his laptop when she left that night, which further contradicts Dion's story that Lance dropped the laptop off with her around 10 p.m.
Lacey and Dion both say that they were with Lance at the same time. Obviously, that's not possible. Somebody is lying.
Investigators decide the best way to figure out who's telling the truth is to take a closer look at both women. In doing so, they uncover a startling report detailing an incident that occurred at Lance Herndon's estate just 1 month prior to his death. An incident involving Dion Baugh and another of Lance's lovers, Kathy Connor.
Dion had been calling Lance throughout the day and he was not responding to her calls. And so at some point, she decided just to show up at his house. And unfortunately, they both got a big surprise.
When she got there, she looked in the window and she saw Lance and Kathy inside the home.
What are you doing?
Kathy knows nothing about Dion. She has no idea who this woman is. And Dion doesn't know who Kathy is. She thinks she's the only one.
Open the door, I need to talk to you!
No!
Please!
No!
Lance has found himself in a predicament here that he had created all by himself. Well, he couldn't tell Kathy who Dion was. And so he had to play this off as some kind of stalker or intruder. And as a result, he called the police.
Hey, there's somebody knocking at my door. And there might be like an ex-girlfriend or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
That's giving me some problems.
Okay. Send somebody out there and have them leave the premises, okay?
They arrested her. They took her away. And I believe that Dion was charged with trespassing and resisting arrest.
But the following morning, perhaps out of guilt, Lance bailed Dion out of jail.
He told Dion that he was going to go to court on her behalf and that he was going to try and get her exonerated of the charges.
They had some trust issues after that moment. They continued to see one another, but I think Lance was walking on eggshells with her. And I think that she no longer trusted Lance.
With so many conflicting stories and a laundry list of jilted lovers, detectives turned their attention to the sole piece of forensic evidence at their disposal, the pubic hair recovered from Lance Herndon's body.
Because Lance was sleeping with several women, the investigators took DNA samples from three of the women that Lance had been with. Lacey, Dion, and Kathy. It was obvious that some DNA would be found on his body. The question was, whose DNA would it be?
Millionaire playboy Lance Herndon has been brutally bludgeoned to death by an unknown assailant. Police have learned that Lance's red-hot love triangle with Kathy Connor and Dion Baugh exploded just weeks before his death, when Dion dropped by his home unannounced.
When she arrived and looked in the window and apparently created a scene in which he wouldn't go to the door and he just called police and they arrested her.
Okay, officer, I'll go.
But following Dion's arrest, Lance bailed her out and promised to have the charges against her dropped.
What he really did was he set in motion a series of events that led to his own murder.
Either the living girlfriend who's grown tired of her million-dollar gigolo, or the Jamaican beauty he's groomed to Atlanta socialite status. Which of these women had more reason to orchestrate his murder?
Adding to the intrigue is the fact that a third woman, Lance's assistant, Lacey Brown, has also admitted to sleeping with him and has been placed at Lance's house the night of the crime.
How does one get to the bottom of this case? We have three scorned women, all with plausible motivation to commit murder.
But a single hair found at the crime scene may just crack this case wide open. Weeks into the investigation, detectives received the results from the state crime lab.
The DNA test actually came back that it was a match to Dion Bao.
With this confirmation, police are confident Dion is the killer. Later that day, Dion Bao is charged with the murder of her lover, Lance Herndon. News of the arrest and of the victim's posh address make waves all over the city of Atlanta.
A lot of people were very fascinated by who the victim was, what kind of lifestyle he had. That generated a lot of interest.
That interest reaches a crescendo at Dion's trial.
An African-American millionaire playboy murdered. This case impacted both the have and have-nots in the city. Everyone wanted to know how this case would play out.
Prosecutors opened by laying out Dion's alleged motive. After catching Lance with Kathy Connor, Dion feared Lance was planning to put an end to both the relationship and, with it, Dion's lavish lifestyle.
The prosecutor theory was he was basically going to dump her, take his car back, take everything back.
Prosecutors claim Dion also feared Lance was going to renege on his promise to have the trespassing charges against her dropped.
Lance always had his day scheduled on his computer. When Dion looked on the computer and didn't see her court date on his calendar, she went into a rage. That was the ultimate rejection.
Prosecutors claim that in order to carry out the crime, Dion plied Lance with the one thing he could never say no to.
Dion, what are you doing here?
Sex.
I know you miss me.
The way the state contended the murder occurred was that Dion had sex with Lance. Lance went to sleep. That Dion started going through a computer and saw that Lance had not scheduled to go to the hearing on the misdemeanor, criminal battery, and that this enraged Dion.
She straddled him in his bed as he slept, and she bludgeoned him to death at a minimum of 12 times.
To support their claim, prosecutors introduced the hair they found on Lance's dead body, the hair that DNA testing proves belongs to Dion.
Certainly the strongest evidence that the prosecution had was the DNA evidence.
But when it's their turn, Dion's attorneys take aim at the DNA evidence.
There was no doubt that Dion Bao was having a love affair with Lance Herndon. Of course there's going to be DNA evidence in his bed.
They dated, they were intimate, and he could have rolled around and it could have been stuck to his body.
The prosecution counters by submitting the report from the incident that took place 1 month prior to the murder, which they say clearly paints Dion as a vindictive and potentially violent person.
Dion's arrest at Lance's home made her appear very angry. So angry that she was attempting to force her way inside his home. This displayed anger showed her ability to act out violently.
In addition to the incident report, prosecutors call one of the case's lead investigators to the stand, who recounts a slew of unflattering stories about Dion. Many of them relayed to him by her and Lance's friends and family.
Investigator Anastasio's comments to the witnesses were based on the type of person Dion was, rather than if the individual was there to commit murder. Most witnesses felt Dion was crazy, a person that couldn't be trusted, so therefore she had to commit the murder.
Lieutenant Anastasio testified to a lot of information that he heard from other parties, from the neighbors of Dion Bao, from people who knew Dion Bao, and from people who knew Lance Herndon.
Defense lawyers are outraged that the judge has allowed such testimony.
It was blatantly hearsay, it was bolstering, it was a violation of the evidentiary rules.
If the prosecution wanted to introduce the evidence of those people, he should call those witnesses to the stand.
But the judge allows the detective's words to stand. With their backs against the ropes, the defense tries to chip away at Dion's alleged motive.
Criminal trespass, which is only a misdemeanor, is a small crime. It didn't make sense that that would lead Dion to kill Lance because he'd reneged on a misdemeanor agreement.
As for the jealousy motive, the defense argues that given Lance's voracious sexual appetite, the line of women who might want to exact some sort of revenge against him is long.
And there are all these women who'd been jilted over the years, and he's got so many women bouncing back and forth every night. There were lots of people who had the ability to actually have been the perpetrator in the case.
After tackling the motive, the defense hammers away at the lack of physical evidence connecting Dion to the crime.
There's nothing that directly links her to that scene at the moment of the murder.
Nor is there a murder weapon implicating Dion.
They didn't find it. I believe, in fact, that they attempted to dig up the backyard of her home and went back there and went to her home, never found anything.
The defense's case is so solid, the seeds of doubt so strong, it seems a guilty verdict is all but impossible.
Just the fact that Dion's hair was found on Lance was not going to be sufficient to convince a jury that she was guilty. It wasn't enough evidence.
Which makes the legal thunderbolt that strikes next all the more shocking.
I've tried a lot of murder cases in the last 32 years. This is unusual. It's not the normal way in which a trial ends.
The case was certainly shocking. We were shocked by the jury.
After 2 weeks of testimony, Dion Baugh's murder trial for the death of her playboy lover, Lance Herndon, is drawing to a close. In a case based almost solely on circumstantial evidence, a guilty verdict seems far from certain.
The defense had a strong argument for reasonable doubt.
No murder weapon. No one actually putting Dion in Lance's home the evening he was killed.
Dion's fate now rests in the hands of the jury. After only a couple of hours of deliberation, they announce they've reached a verdict. They find Dion Baugh guilty of murder.
She's convicted of murder, and in Georgia, that's an automatic life sentence.
It was a compliment to the prosecutor, because all they had tying Dion Baugh to the crime was a hair and some DNA on a person that she had admitted to being sexually active with.
Dion was very cool during the entire trial, but when the verdict was handed down, she wept.
Outraged over what he feels was inadmissible testimony on the part of Detective Anastasio, defense attorney Don Samuel appeals the verdict.
It's not proper to call a policeman to the stand and have him simply repeat what witnesses told him. That's hearsay.
With Dion locked up in prison, the appeal eventually makes its way to the Georgia Supreme Court.
It took well over a year for the Supreme Court to decide the case. She was very hopeful of getting a new trial, insisted on her innocence throughout.
On July 10th, 2003, 2 years after her sentencing, the Georgia Supreme Court announces their decision. The jury's original verdict is overturned.
The Supreme Court agreed with the defense. And so they sent the case back for retrial.
As in the first trial, Dion's defense team attacks the lack of physical evidence. But this time, they also launch a full-on assault on Lance Herndon's character.
During the second trial, the defense was able to puncture Lance's character even more and create a broader landscape of enemies that he may have had.
Usually it is the advantage of the defense to have a second trial because you've learned all the state's secrets by then.
Still, everyone in the jury believes Dion to be guilty, except for one.
There was one juror who just couldn't find it in their heart to find her guilty.
And that's all it takes. All it takes is one hung juror, and you're not acquitted, but you're also not convicted. So the trial ends, and everybody goes home. You start over again.
The prospect of a third trial takes its toll on everyone, including Lance Herndon's family.
They were tired of hearing Lance Herndon being kind of dragged through the mud. So the prosecutors said, let's see if we can reach a settlement that everybody can live with. And that's what happened.
Dion was floated an offer by the state of voluntary manslaughter with a sentence of 10 years in prison.
Having served 2 years while her case was on appeal, Dion takes the deal.
She decided to cut her losses. In one case, she was convicted, and another time, she had a mistrial. And she didn't want to roll the dice one more time and took the 10 years.
In July of 2011, after completing her sentence, Dion Baugh walks out of jail a free woman. But questions about her guilt or innocence linger to this day.
I wouldn't stake my life on the fact that Dion was the killer in this case. There was just too many question marks.
Island beauty in search of the American dream.
She was ambitious, she was intelligent, and she was trying to better herself.
When their stars collide, their steamy romance plays out like an X-rated movie.
Sexually, they were like fireworks. He told people that she satisfied him in a way that no one else satisfied him.
But just when their carnal lust reaches its peak, an intimate secret is exposed.
For him to have such a secret life, that was a shock.
And the consequences are deadly.
When someone is beaten, that really, blood splatters everywhere.
Investigators soon uncover a bevy of beautiful suspects, each with their own lurid connection to the victim.
He really led a secret life. Sometimes that would include threesomes, foursomes.
There were lots of people who had motive. There were lots of people who had opportunity.
This was one of the most gruesome scenes that I had seen. The question is, who was angry enough to have done this?
August 8, 1996. It's a serene morning in the upscale Atlanta suburb of Roswell, Georgia. But that tranquility is shattered when police receive a desperate 911 call.
One of the most gruesome scenes that I had seen. The question is, who was angry enough to have done this?
August 8, 1996. It's a serene morning in the upscale Atlanta suburb of Roswell, Georgia. But that tranquility is shattered when police receive a desperate 911 call. On the line is Jackie Herndon.
Emergency, somebody done killed my baby.
Okay, tell me what's going on.
I don't know, I came in the house, he's 40 years old, I found him in the bed. Hurry, police.
Police rush to the address and race upstairs to the master bedroom.
Police department.
What they find is unsettling to even the most seasoned officers.
Room is unbelievably bloody. The sheets are covered in blood. The pillowcases are covered with blood. It is a very terrible scene.
In the bed is the naked, lifeless body of a middle-aged African-American male.
Major crimes and forensics.
His head was battered in a very forceful way, no less than 14 times.
The victim is identified as Jackie's son, 41-year-old Lance Herndon. A successful and highly regarded businessman in the Atlanta community.
Lance was a high roller. He had a beautiful home in Roswell.
Dion had been calling Lance throughout the day, and he was not responding to her calls. And so at some point, she decided just to show up at his house. And unfortunately, they both got a big surprise.
When she got there, she looked in the window, and she saw Lance and Kathy inside the home.
What are you doing?
Kathy knows nothing about Dion. She has no idea who this woman is. And Dion doesn't know who Kathy is. She thinks she's the only one.
Open the door, I need to talk to you!
No!
Please!
No!
Lance has found himself in a predicament here that he had created all by himself. Well, he couldn't tell Kathy who Dion was, and so he had to play this off as some kind of stalker or intruder, and as a result, he called the police.
Hey, there's somebody knocking at my door, and it might be like an ex-girlfriend or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
That's giving me some problems.
Okay. Send somebody out there and have them leave the premises, okay?
And they arrested her. They took her away. And I believe that Dion was charged with trespassing and resisting arrest.
But the following morning, perhaps out of guilt, Lance bailed Dion out of jail.
He told Dion that he was going to go to court on her behalf and that he was going to try and get her exonerated of the charges.
She thinks she's the only one.
Open the door, I need to talk to you!
No!
Please!
No!
Lance has found himself in a predicament here that he had created all by himself. Well, he couldn't tell Kathy who Dion was, and so he had to play this off as some kind of stalker or intruder, and as a result, he called the police.
Hey, there's somebody knocking at my door, and there might be like an ex-girlfriend or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
That's giving me some problems.
Okay. Send somebody out there and have them leave the premises, okay?
They arrested her. They took her away. And I believe that Dion was charged with trespassing and resisting arrest.
But the following morning, perhaps out of guilt, Lance bailed Dion out of jail.
He told Dion that he was going to go to court on her behalf and that he was going to try and get her exonerated of the charges.
They had some trust issues after that moment. They continued to see one another. But I think Lance was walking on eggshells with her, and I think that she no longer trusted Lance.
With so many conflicting stories and a laundry list of jilted lovers, detectives turned their attention to the sole piece of forensic evidence at their disposal. The pubic hair recovered technically still lives in Jamaica.
Once an unalibied suspect leaves the country, concrete leads may quickly deteriorate. Continuing the investigation brings on legal, economic, and time constraints.
But with the help of Sean's airline employer, detectives are able to track him down. They make the trip to Jamaica to interview Sean at his home.
Can I help you?
The investigation was very thorough. They did go to Jamaica. They interviewed her husband down there, found out a lot about what happened.
Sean readily admits his wife's affair left a bitter taste in his mouth. But he's adamant he had nothing to do with Lance's death.
I hated him. I hate what he did to my family.
As detectives continue their conversation, it becomes evident Sean couldn't have committed the crime.
Time of death indicates Lance was killed sometime between 2 and 3 a.m. By this time, Sean was already heading back to Jamaica. In fact, he had already landed.
Thank you very much.
With their investigation at a standstill, detectives reach out to friends and family for more information about their victim. In doing so, they unearth another unexpected surprise. Turns out Dion wasn't the only one juggling multiple lovers. Not by a long shot.
They said that they couldn't keep up with the amount of people that he was sleeping with.
Lance had a harem of women, and he saw women as objects and someone.
Crescendo at Dion's trial.
An African-American millionaire playboy murdered. This case impacted both the have and have-nots in the city. Everyone wanted to know how this case would play out.
Prosecutors opened by laying out Dion's alleged motive. After catching Lance with Kathy Connor, Dion feared Lance was planning to put an end to both the relationship and, with it, Dion's lavish lifestyle.
The prosecutor theory was he was basically going to dump her, take his car back, take everything back.
Prosecutors claim Dion also feared Lance was going to renege on his promise to have the trespassing charges against her dropped.
Lance always had his day scheduled on his computer. When Dion looked on the computer and didn't see her court date on his calendar, she went into a rage. That was the ultimate rejection.
Prosecutors claim that in order to carry out the crime, Dion plied Lance with the one thing he could never say no to.
Dion, what are you doing here?
Sex.
I know you miss me.
The way the state contended the murder occurred was that Dion had sex with Lance. Lance went to sleep. That Dion started going through a computer and saw that Lance had not scheduled to go to the hearing on the misdemeanor, criminal battery, and that this enraged Dion.
She straddled him in his bed as he slept.
Went to her home, never found anything.
The defense's case is so solid, the seeds of doubt so strong, it seems a guilty verdict is all but impossible.
Just the fact that Dion's hair was found on Lance was not going to be sufficient to convince a jury that she was guilty. It wasn't enough evidence.
Which makes the legal thunderbolt that strikes next all the more shocking.
I've tried a lot of murder cases in the last 32 years. This is unusual. It's not the normal way in which a trial ends.
The case was certainly shocking. We were shocked by the jury.
After 2 weeks of testimony, Dion Ball's murder trial for the death of her playboy lover, Lance Herndon, is drawing to a close. In a case based almost solely on circumstantial evidence, a guilty verdict seems far from certain.
The defense had a strong argument for reasonable doubt.
No murder weapon. No one actually putting Dion in Lance's home the evening he was killed.
Dion's fate now rests in the hands of the jury. After only a couple of hours of deliberation, they announce they've reached a verdict. They find Dion Baugh guilty of murder.
She's convicted of murder, and in Georgia, that's an automatic life sentence.
It was a compliment to the prosecutor, because all they had tying Dion Baugh to the crime was a hair and some DNA on a person that she had admitted to being sexually active with.
Dion was very cool.
Kathy.
According to Lance's friends, Lance was as hot and heavy with Kathy as he was with Dion.
She had the clothes in the closet. She was allowed to stay over when other women had to leave after he was finished.
Kathy was what most would have considered his sort of trophy. If you saw Lance out at a formal event, it was probably with Kathy. She was definitely eye candy for him publicly.
Which, to investigators, explains the real reason Lance and Dion weren't living together and why they seem to spend most of their time getting it on in the bedroom rather than hitting the town.
Kathy did not know about Dion. Dion did not know about Kathy.
Is it possible that Kathy eventually found out about Dion and murdered Lance in a jealous rage?
Obviously, Lance had cheated on her quite a bit, so she would have been a natural suspect as well.
But detectives don't have to wait long for a chance to speak with Kathy. 1 week into the investigation, she storms into the police station.
She sashays in, she sits down, and she's mad. She's upset because the police have not allowed her to go back into the home to get her clothes. So the police are thinking this woman is more concerned about her expensive clothes than she is her boyfriend.
Investigators cut to the chase.
So where were you then?
She tells them that she was
open up Atlanta to her. So he took her out, he spent a lot of money, and he courted her, and she responded to that.
But when Lance is found brutally murdered in his own bedroom, investigators question Dion and learn the couple's relationship wasn't everything it appeared to be.
Dion was actually married. She had a husband named Sean who lived in Jamaica with their 4-year-old daughter.
This is Sean.
Not only that, but according to Dion, shortly before the murder, Lance and her husband had a heated exchange.
Don't ever call my house again.
Maybe I won't call.
Maybe I'll just come over there. How about that? Don't ever call my house again.
Within this conversation, between the screaming and yelling, threats were made.
Dion also informs police that Sean was actually in town the day of the murder.
Sean had been in Atlanta visiting Dion just before the murder. How ironic that he left for Jamaica the evening Lance was killed.
Police are anxious to talk to Sean Nelson, but Dion explains that Sean technically still lives in Jamaica.
Once an unalibied suspect leaves the country, concrete leads may quickly deteriorate. Continuing the investigation brings on legal, economic, and time constraints.
But with the help of Sean's airline employer, detectives are able to track him down. They make the trip to Jamaica to interview Sean at his home.
Can I help you?
He's been dead 5 to 7 hours. But as they survey the scene inside the opulent master bedroom, investigators can't help but wonder if someone targeted the dashing businessman for his money.
Lance Herndon had become a very powerful man. He was very successful. He was making money and people recognized him.
But an initial search of Lance's residence suggests otherwise.
Nothing of value is missing. His wallet is on the table. Money's still in it. His IDs are still there. Everything of value is still in place.
But in Lance's office, investigators determined there is one item of value missing.
That might be a laptop. Mm. Check that bag.
They noticed his laptop wasn't there.
Lance was a shrewd businessman in the dog-eat-dog world of technology. Is it possible his murder was the work of an adversary looking to take out their primary competition?
He also had other things going on from a business standpoint that could have created other suspects in this case, other people that had an axe to grind with him, other people that broadened the field of suspects.
According to Lance's mother, who made the initial 911 call, the idea that her son was loathed by his competitors doesn't hold water.
They're telling the police everything that they know about Lance. They don't think he has any enemies. He got along with everybody and he was...
Obviously, Lance had cheated on her quite a bit, so she would have been a natural suspect as well.
But detectives don't have to wait long for a chance to speak with Kathy. 1 week into the investigation, she storms into the police station.
She sashays in, she sits down, and she's mad. She's upset because the police have not allowed her to go back into the home to get her clothes. So the police are thinking this woman is more concerned about her expensive clothes than she is her boyfriend.
Investigators cut to the chase.
So where were you then?
She tells them that she was going to spend the night with another millionaire.
Detectives look into Kathy's story and determine she did indeed spend the evening with her other lover, another of Atlanta's wealthiest black businessmen.
Police were able to verify everything that Kathy said, so she was ruled out.
With Kathy Connor in the clear, investigators turn to the next woman on Lance Herndon's overflowing Rolodex of lovers, one who appears to be the wildest and perhaps most lethal of them all.
Lance would lend her to his friends. She basically would do anything that he asked of her in exchange for financial gain.
In a suburb of Atlanta, Georgia, detectives are on the hunt for the killer of wealthy businessman Lance Herndon. And after running down a pair of rival girls,